This is where Tolkien was in November 1916. He'd spent 4 months in the Battle of the Somme, the worst battle the world had yet seen. And he'd come out of it with a lucky louse bite that brought him home with trench fever. At that time, this campus was at least partly, maybe wholly, I'm not sure, in control of the Royal Army Medical Corps. During the course of the war, they started off with just over 500 beds here, and by the end they had 1,500. And then there were outlying sections that had a couple more thousand. And during the war, they treated 130,569 patients. One of the key figures here was Dr. Gamgee, Dr. Leonard Gamgee, the son of Samson Gamgee. Now, the reason that Tolkien called his character Sam Gamgee, the way he tells it, is that Gamgee was a local dialect word which came from the surname of Samson Gamgee, because he invented a surgical dressing called Gamgee wool. And then it got attached to a curious character that the Tolkien children saw on holiday on the south coast. And then Tolkien decided that Gamgee had to be a surname of a hobbit because it suited. But nonetheless, it seems to me entirely suitable that Sam Gamgee somehow memorialises the healing figure who presided over this military hospital when Tolkien was here. And Tolkien certainly knew him, and he certainly knew of his existence when he started writing The Lord of the Rings, because at that point they were both members of the King Edward's School Board of Governors. So they probably attended, they did attend at least one meeting together. I'm going to take you on a there and back again journey. Mostly focusing on Lord of the Rings, which I hope you're all familiar with. I'm talking about, it's a book, right? But most of what I say also applies in the movie, with a few honourable exceptions, like I think the opening scene that I'm going to talk about. So, actually, I'm going to go back because that quote's going to distract you at the moment. We are close to the end of The Lord of the Rings. Faramir, the new steward of Gondor, is suffering from, or recovering from, close contact with the Ringwraiths. He's been suffering from something called the Black Breath. But also, or perhaps it's the same thing, with a kind of war trauma, because he has been forced to go into the front line, forced to do his duty, despite already being very, very frighteningly aware of the dangers. And he's there with Éowyn, Shield Maiden of Rohan, who has also encountered the Ringwraiths and suffered accordingly. And they look towards Mordor, the land of the enemy, where the army of Minas Tirith, the army of Gondor, has gone to pathetically challenge the might of the Dark Lord Sauron. And Faramir is trying to say to Éowyn that he loves her, but he can't quite get it out. They've just met in this hospital, the Houses of Healing of Minas Tirith. She says, "Let us not speak at all. I stand upon some dreadful brink, and it is utterly dark in the abyss before my feet. I wait for some stroke of doom. Yes, we wait for the stroke of doom, said Faramir. And it seemed to them as they stood upon the wall that the wind died and the light failed and the sun was bleared and all sounds were hushed. The very beating of their hearts was stilled. Time halted. And still they waited, for they knew not what. Then presently it seemed to them that above the ridges of the distant mountains, another vast mountain of darkness rose, towering up like a wave that should engulf the world. And about it, lightnings flickered. And then a tremor ran through the earth, and they felt the walls of the city quiver. A sound like a sigh went up from all the lands about them, and their hearts beat suddenly again. It reminds me of Numenor, said Faramir, and wondered to hear himself speak. Of Numenor? Said Éowyn. Yes, said Faramir, of the land of Westerness that foundered, and of the great dark wave climbing over the green lands and above the hills, and coming on, darkness unescapable. I often dream of it. Now, thank you, Hokusai, for the illustration of the Great Wave here. Tolkien had this nightmare that he gave to Faramir. I have what some might call an Atlantis complex. I mean the terrible recurrent dream of the Great Wave. He says he dreamt of it coming, towering over green fields as if to engulf them. And it would surge over him and he would wake at the point of drowning. So a truly terrifying experience. He'd wake up gasping. It still occurs occasionally, though now exorcised by writing about it. In my last book, The Worlds of J.R.R. Tolkien, I have hazarded a guess that in some way, perhaps, this wave nightmare was associated with the fact that when he was very young, when he was not yet four, he was brought over the ocean by his mother from southern Africa all the way to England, never to go home to the place where he was born and never to see his father again, because his father died less than a year later before the family could be reunited. He ran a bank in the city of Bloemfontein, which is now part of South Africa. Whatever the cause, this great wave image is very appropriate to catastrophe and disaster. When Tolkien's mother died, and he was just 12 years old, he said he felt like a castaway beneath a silent sky, as if there were no God. And this is a man of deep faith. I don't know how many of you watched the Rings of Power Amazon Prime series. Virtually the only bit I really liked was Muriel's vision of the great wave coming in to annihilate the island realm of Numenor. It's, as I say, a common image of disaster. I mean, one other example, which is worth thinking about. 1914, the pioneer of psychoanalytics, Carl Jung, had a dream in which he saw a vision of the whole of Europe flooded. This was on the eve of the Great War, virtually, and he associated it with that event. And Tolkien thought his own dream might be an ancestral memory. The disasters for Tolkien had not finished with the deaths of his parents, because the First World War swept away many of his friends. Just after Tolkien had first experienced battle at the Somme, he learned that his close old friend Robert Quilter Gilson, when I say an old friend, I mean a friend a little younger than him, actually, whom he had known at school, a member of their circle, the Tea Club and Barovian Society, the TCBS, had been killed on the first day of the Somme, leading his company across no man's land. While Tolkien was here, at the start of December 1916, another friend, Geoffrey Bache Smith, from that same circle, was killed on the Somme battlefield, though the battle had finished. He was hit by a stray shell while trying to organise a football match, and he walked away with a little shrapnel injury, and then he got gangrene, and he was dead 3 days later. The first book that Tolkien published was not one of his own. It was an edition of G.B. Smith's poetry called A Spring Harvest. And one of the poems in there is in memory, it's by Smith, but it's in memory of Gilson. It's called Let Us Tell Quiet Stories of Kind Eyes. And there's a verse in there which illustrates what I mean about the great wave. And again, this idea that, you know, let's not speak amid this horror, that thing that Éowyn says. Let's have no word of all the sweat and blood, of all the noise and strife and dust and smoke. We who have seen death surging like a flood, wave upon wave that leapt and raced and broke. So that's just a glimpse of the kind of thing. That's actually a picture spread from Tolkien and the Great War. The scenery of the Somme battlefield, blasted chalk. It's very much down, like southern England, very much downland. So once you get below the green grass, you get to white. And in the autumn, it became a rain-soaked, flooded mire. So after the Great Southern General Hospital, which is what this place was called at the time, Tolkien went to convalesce with his wife, Edith, who lived in Great Heywood, just north of Cannock Chase. And there, he began writing what he called the Book of Lost Tales. It's the first version of what we now call the Silmarillion. He remembered later that it was a result of his desire to express his feeling about good, evil, fair, foul in some way, to rationalize it and prevent it just festering. It generated Morgoth and the history of the gnomes, as he called the high elves in those days, lots of the early parts of which, and the languages, were done in grimy canteens, at lectures in cold fogs, in huts full of blasphemy and smut, or by candlelight in bell tents, even some down in dugouts under shell fire. One of the first stories he wrote, or perhaps, in fact, the first story he wrote, talks about a voyager, a mortal mariner arriving in the lonely Isle of the Elves. Now, If you've read Lord of the Rings, you will know of the Lonely Isle of the Elves, Tol Eressëa. If you have read the Silmarillion, you'll know more about it. What you may not know is that in Tolkien's early mythology, Tol Eressëa, the Lonely Isle of the Elves, was the island of Britain. It was meant to be Britain in an enchanted past, and this was why Britain was special to Tolkien. So the idea of this mariner, Ariel, arriving in the Lonely Isle is quite striking, because Tolkien had just arrived in Britain on a ship, on a hospital ship. So this kind of retreads his own journey. And there in the island of the elves, Ariel hears the tales of the elves. And the first one he hears is a creation myth in which the world is created by an order of angels and their creator, the Ainur and god, Ilúvatar, through a heavenly music. And the way it works is this. Ilúvatar announces a theme which he wants the angels, the Ainur, to play, to sing. Like a great, a kind of cross between an orchestra and a fantastic jazz band, because they're allowed to extemporize. It's a creative, collaborative experience. And I think this is because, for Tolkien, free will was absolutely a vital ethos. In this case, free will means that the angels can do what they like. Most of them want to express themselves according to the divine theme that's been presented to them, but one does not. And he is the satanic rebel, who Tolkien later called Morgoth, Sauron's boss. Ilúvatar says, after the music has turned to chaos and then been rescued by a new theme and then turned to chaos again and been redeemed by a third theme, through him, the rebel angel, has pain and misery been made in the clash of overwhelming musics, and with confusion of sound have cruelty and ravening and darkness, loathly mire and all putrescence of thought or thing, foul mists and violent flame, cold without mercy being born, and death without hope. These are really striking images. So what he's saying is the discord that's been woven into this music of creation is going to create discord and suffering in the world that's been created. And the examples that he gives describe the trench experience, the Battle of the Somme, almost exactly. This, I think, is one of the first examples of Tolkien working through his idea of good and evil, fair and foul, rationalizing it, preventing it from just festering. And Ilúvatar, God, gives a redemptive message to the order of angels. And he says that ultimately, as the music was resolved by these new themes, through the free will of those who live within the world, the created world, the music will come right again in the end. And in the meantime, the story of the world will be filled with sorrow, but also glory, with despair, but also hope, with darkness, but also light. That's my copy of The Lord of the Rings. I guess I read that copy about seven times and thumbed it a lot more than that in the space of 4 years or something like that, starting when I was nine. And I want to use that because I'm going to be talking about, you know, ordinary and unprepossessing things that become marvels. While Tolkien was writing The Lord of the Rings, He gave a lecture called On Fairy Stories at St. Andrew's University in Scotland. And he revised it for publication, also while he was writing The Lord of the Rings. And he talks about how fairy stories can deliver three things: recovery, escape, and consolation. I'm going to be focusing on recovery here, but not recovery alone. What he describes as recovery in fairy stories, and he regarded Lord of the Rings as a fairy story. His lecture at that time is like a kind of manifesto for that particular book, that particular fairy story. Recovery is the regaining of a clear view of things. So when we become over-familiar with stuff, it becomes trite and dull. We don't notice it. Even things that are people, that are dear to us, right? But fantasy, fairy stories, allow us to see things as we are or were meant to see them, as things apart from ourselves. So this is a kind of anti-materialist view, I think. He's talking about re-enchanting the world, re-enchanting the things around us so that we no longer feel we own them, so that they can enchant us, potentially. Creative fantasy, he says, may open your hoard and let all the locked things fly away like cage birds. The gems all turn into flowers or flames, and you will be warned that all you had or knew was dangerous and potent, not really effectively chained, free and wild. And it's rather like Bilbo walking into Smaug's chamber in The Hobbit and seeing this vast hoard there. The dragon knows the value of every gem and coin in the hoard in money terms, but nothing about its artistry, the craft inside it, or what it ever meant to people. There's another hoard in The Lord of the Rings, the hoard of the Barrow-wight, which Tom Bombadil, not in the movie, Tom Bombadil scatters on the grass for anyone to take, apart from one particular brooch set with blue stones, many shaded like flax flowers or the wings of butterflies. He looks as if it stirred some memory, and he says, "Fair was she who long ago wore this." So he is aware of the beauty of the brooch, but he actually remembers what it meant to someone in particular years and years ago, centuries ago. He's long lived. Is this kind of recovery the same thing as a recovery from illness? Well, I think in a sense it is for Tolkien. But let me go to another bit of On Fairy Stories. And I'm going to introduce a word that Tolkien coined, eucatastrophe. So he's taking a Greek word meaning a turn, catastrophe, and adding a Greek word meaning good. So a turning point that is good, the opposite of what we think of as catastrophe, which properly speaking would be discatastrophe, a bad turning point. He talks about the consolation of the happy ending, the consolation of fairy stories, the joy of the happy ending, or more correctly, of the good catastrophe, the sudden joyous turn. A sudden, this is probably on the screen, there we are, a sudden miraculous grace never to be counted on to recur. It does not deny the existence of discatastrophe, of sorrow and failure. The possibility of these is necessary to the joy of deliverance. This is like Ilúvatar saying, you know, there has to be light, dark for there to be light. It denies, in the face of much evidence, if you will, universal final defeat. And so, and in so far is Evangelium, giving a fleeting glimpse of joy, joy beyond the walls of the world, poignant as grief. Evangelium means good tidings. It's the Latin word for gospel. Back again. The Lord of the Rings takes the ordinary and releases from it the extraordinary. It's full of ordinary miracles. The ordinary become the miraculous. The hobbits, essentially completely ordinary people, especially Sam Gamgee, I think the real hero of the book. Aragorn, the coming king, is a bloke down the pub. Strider, right? Dodgy looking character. Knows a lot about flowers and plants, as does Sam Gamgee. The thing he uses to heal, the hands of the king are the hands of the healer, is a saying, but he uses a plant that's been completely overlooked by the herbalists, something called athalas. I don't think Tolkien's being scientific here. I don't think he's talking about, you know, something that works like the miracle of penicillin or aspirin that comes from willow. It's an ordinary miracle. Gandalf is an ordinary wizard, if you can imagine such a thing, right? Because he sits and smokes a pipe with you, right? He lights fireworks for the kids. Let's go back to what Tolkien said about his desire, first of all, after the Battle of the Somme, to express his sense of fair and foul, good and evil, and to prevent it from just festering. And think also of his line about how, when he wrote about the Great Wave in his story of the Fall of Numenor, it exorcised his lifelong nightmare. When his son Michael, who suffered from terrible bad dreams, including one of the Great Wave, actually, was about 8, I think, his father tried to draw a couple of the creatures that Michael dreamt about. One was called Maddo, and was a hand that crept around the curtain, a disembodied hand. The other was called Owlamu, a very scary owl. Maddo and Owlamu were two of Michael's imagined bogies when he was about 6 to 8 years old, Tolkien wrote. I tried to draw them from his descriptions, which seemed to rob them of terror and leave them merely nursery mythological creatures. I think this is really one of the keys to what Tolkien is doing in his creative writing. Really simple. But you can see it working again and again. Let's talk about the Black Riders, the Ringwraiths. Initially, you know, what do we know about them? They suddenly appear in your homeland. They are frightening, strange, much bigger than you, twice as big as you, a giant. You can't see their faces. You can hear their breath. You can hear them shriek in the distance, this thin, wailing shriek. And they're terrifying. Sam has a conversation with the elves that they meet in the Shire. And he remembers it. Don't you leave him, they said to me. Leave him, I said. I never mean to. I am going to with him if he climbs to the moon. And if any of those black riders try to stop him, they'll have Sam Gamgee to reckon with, I said. They laughed. And it does seem a bit unlikely that Sam is going to be any good at coping with black riders. After Frodo is stabbed by the chief ringwraith on Weathertop, he falls very ill, the poison blade in him working its way towards his heart. And as they travel on towards Rivendell, Frodo lay half in a dream, imagining that endless dark wings were sweeping by above him, and that on the wings rode pursuers that sought him in all the hollows of the hills. So there's a lot in The Lord of the Rings about Frodo's dreams. And the book is kind of Frodo's psychological journey. It gets a lot worse. And we know when we've read ahead, looking back at these words, that clearly Frodo has some kind of prevision of the flying ringwraiths, the Black Riders, when they start riding around on pterodactyls. However, when Tolkien wrote this, we can see from his drafts, he apparently did not know this. So where does he get these images from? Is it a nightmare that Tolkien had, again, that he gave to one of his characters? When the characters encounter the ringwraiths or other forms of terror in The Lord of the Rings, like the paths of the dead, when Gimli, we see the journey into the paths of the dead through the eyes of Gimli the dwarf, and for him, it's as if there's a grey vapour of fear flowing from this gateway that they have to go into. And he ends up on his hands and knees, crawling, blind with fear. When Merry crawls up behind the Lord of the Ringwraiths to stab in the back of the knee, he's crawling blind in the mud, filled with terror. This is what terror does. And the one time that Tolkien, in any published writing, mentions the experience of war, personally, it's in two words: animal horror. The animal horror of active life on Earth, he says in his letters. And I think that exactly epitomizes what we see in The Lord of the Rings when despair strikes. The Lord of the Rings is a battle for morale against despair, as much as it's a battle of any kind. One of the most famous scenes of fear in The Lord of the Rings arose just after Tolkien came back to Birmingham in 1944. He'd been stumped as a writer he'd been suffering writer's block for a year or so in the middle of The Lord of the Rings. And Frodo and Sam were lost in the hills of the Emyn Mool on their way towards Mordor. He came back for a school reunion at the new King Edward School, which is just over the road here. But the school that he had known is the one in the picture there on the left, an amazing Victorian Gothic building by Charles Barry, who went on to build the Houses of Parliament. And he said in a letter to his son Christopher, it's been replaced by a ghastly shopping mall. He doesn't use that phrase, but you know, that's the kind of thing. He hates the architecture. You know, he's deeply saddened and horrified. And he writes, "I couldn't stand much of that, or the ghosts that rose from the pavements. So I caught a tram to the new school for the reunion." He said the architecture was worse than the German bombing, which he saw as well. And I think it's really telling that he talks about the ghost that rose from the pavements. What does he mean? Did he see a vision? Maybe. Tolkien was very imaginative. Was it just seeing the memories of faces? Probably. But all the same, these are the faces of friends, many of whom were killed in the First World War, because so many of his generation were. And in the Dead Marshes, it's where the First World War really sweeps over what goes on in the book. Frodo starts to be more bowed down by the weight of the ring, by the sense of being watched by the Eye of Sauron. Lots of crawling and crouching now. The ring wraiths fly over, right? So you've got airborne enemies observing you. The pools around you are filled with the faces of the dead. This is a mythologizing of real memory. In the autumn on the Somme, this is what you could see. And going back to that dream of Frodo's about the flapping wings, going back to the screaming shriek of the ringwraiths, if you read descriptions of what artillery shells sounded like as they were coming towards you, they sounded like, they shrieked, they came shrieking down towards the trenches, and certain kinds that were built like barrels turned over, making a sound like flapping wings. Let me go back one again. I hate to talk about formulae, but if you look at the formula, the pattern, if you like, the pattern of the tapestry of Lord of the Rings, that's a nicer way of putting it. We have often unseen horror. You can't see the Black Riders' faces, right? We have horrors that are suddenly revealed. The arms of the Watcher in the Water that come out to try to grab Frodo. You have peril to the max, right? You have the challenge of something like the Ringwraith surrounding you, the Balrog on the bridge in Hazardum. You have it driven off, or perhaps even ultimately and surprisingly, astonishingly, against all hope and expectation, defeated, and a moment of eucatastrophe, the sudden turn. Let's take the example of the dead, or the undead, the ringwraiths, the barrow white, the faces in those dead marshes, and then the dead men of Dunharrow, where there's a eucatastrophic turn, because Aragorn is able to recruit the ghosts of dead men to take part in battle against Sauron, the necromancer, turning the enemy's weapons against himself. And in the end, in the climactic scene, spoilers, on Mount Doom, the ringwraiths fly into the erupting volcano and they wither, crackle, and go out. And I think it's fair to say that they would not have been destroyed but for Sam Gamgee, who did it after all. Let's go back to Gandalf. An ordinary wizard with his MacBook. We have Moria, labyrinthine tunnels, the doom drums in the deep, spears that suddenly come round corners to stab you. These are all trench nightmares, right? You're in the dugout in the trenches, and there is every chance, this is what you're there to defend against, that an enemy will come down the steps with a bayonet, and that will be that. Imagine trying to sleep if you're nightmare prone. The Balrog appears, kind of anti-Gandalf, right? Because Gandalf is a an angel with, he says, I'm the servant of the secret fire. The Balrog is a fire demon. And this is followed by Gandalf's seeming death and his resurrection. But he's still Gandalf, he's still an ordinary angel. And his first achievement when he returns from the dead is the healing of Théoden, king of Rohan. Which, if you read that scene, it's almost like in the film, it's ever so fast. You can't really tell what Gandalf has done except broken an enchantment, let the light in. He's broken the enchantment of Wormtongue, Théoden's corrupt advisor. And I think it's really telling. Wormtongue calls Gandalf Lathspell. This is a word from Old English. It means bad tidings, your bad news, right? And it's the reverse of the Old English Godspell. Good tidings, good news, gospel, evangelium. This is what an angel delivers. And that takes us back to the quote about eucatastrophe, giving us a glimpse of evangelium, the truth as Tolkien saw it, beyond the world. The miracle of The Lord of the Rings, that tatty book that I showed you, is it's in its darkness and its scale and its complexity, something that rewards repeated readings. I think you'll probably agree. It all comes together astonishingly with scenes of joy and healing, but still with this undertow of grief and loss. Very much like the First World War, perhaps. So this is Sam Gamgee waking up from the last thing he knew was he was about to die on the slopes of this erupting volcano. And he's now wakes up in among green trees in Ithilien. Sam lay back and stared with open mouth. And for a moment, between bewilderment and great joy, he could not answer the person who's just spoken to him. At last, he gasped, Gandalf, I thought you were dead, but then I thought I was dead myself. Is everything sad going to come untrue? What's happened to the world? A great shadow has departed, said Gandalf, and then he laughed, and the sound was like music or like water in a parched land. And as he listened, the thought came to Sam that he had not heard laughter, the pure sound of merriment, for days upon days without count. It fell upon his ears like the echo of all the joys he had ever known, but he himself burst into tears. Then, as a sweet rain will pass down a wind of spring and the sun will shine out the clearer, his tears ceased and his laughter welled up. And laughing, he sprang from the bed. How do I feel? He cried. Well, I don't know how to say it. I feel, he waved his arms in the air. I feel like spring after winter and sun on the leaves and like trumpets and harps and all the songs I have ever heard. He's hearing the music of the Ainur again, as it should be played. There is, in The Lord of the Rings, healing that works and healing that does not work. So we have Merry the Hobbit, who has, as we last saw, been crawling in the mud in blind terror, helping Éowyn destroy the Lord of the Ringwraiths. And in the Houses of Healing, Aragorn says, and I think it's really noteworthy that in this great epic book, Tolkien has a whole chapter on a hospital, right? Aragorn says, I came in time and I have called him back. He is weary now and grieved and he has taken a hurt like the Lady Éowyn, daring to smite that deadly thing. but these evils can be amended, so strong and gay a spirit is in him. His grief he will not forget, but it will not darken his heart. It will teach him wisdom. And I think we have some wise advice here from a man, Tolkien, who had survived grief and trauma himself. Merry wants to have a smoke of his pipe, and then he says, oh no, I don't think I'll smoke again. He is dead, Théoden, king of Rohan. He said he was sorry that he had never had a chance of talking herb lore with me, talking about tobacco. Almost the last thing he ever said. I shan't ever be able to smoke again without thinking of him. Smoke then and think of him, said Aragorn. Though your service to him was brief, it should be a memory glad and honourable to the end of your days. And then with Faramir, also suffering from a kind of war trauma. As for Faramir, said Gandalf, he must soon learn that his father, Denethor, is dead. But the full tale of the madness of Denethor should not be told to him until he is quite healed and has duties to do. See that Beregond and the Perian, the halfling who were present, do not speak to him of these things yet. So more wise advice, you know, don't dwell on horror and grief until you've got something to do. So, back to the battlement scene with Faramir and Éowyn. Faramir has just described how that wave of darkness rising above the mountains of Mordor reminds him of Numenor, the land that foundered. Then you think that the darkness is coming, said Éowyn, darkness unescapable. And suddenly she drew close to him. No, said Faramir, looking into her face. It was but a picture in the mind. I do not know what is happening. The reason of my waking mind tells me that great evil has befallen and we stand at the end of days. But my heart says nay, and all my limbs are light, and a hope and joy are come to me that no reason can deny. Éowyn, Éowyn, White Lady of Rohan, in this hour I do not believe that any darkness will endure. And I think there we have encapsulated the lesson of Aulmu, that owl picture that Tolkien drew for his son. Faramir has been afflicted by this nightmare all his life, and it is an inherited nightmare. It's the true dream, the true vision of the land of his ancestors that was destroyed by Sauron. Now he has seen an image of that wave rising up. And what it symbolizes is the revenge of the Numenoreans, the destruction of the force that destroyed their homeland. And it's just a picture. Tolkien has made this nightmare into just a picture. He has mythologized it and exorcised it as part of his own healing. And finally, I would say that the whole of Tolkien's Middle-earth, all of his writings, were for him the houses of healing. I'm not a psychologist, so I'm guessing now, but it seems to me highly likely that that creative ability to deal with good and evil and fair and foul and stop them from just festering helped Tolkien to go forward in life without the awful shadow behind him that could still have destroyed him, because there were people, including a chap called George Bonner, who was on the outskirts of the TCBS who could not shake it and threw himself out of the window in 1927. You know, Tolkien was able to go forward, and not only that, but to bring us into this world that, well, I don't know about you, but it's brought me recovery in both senses of the word, making anew things that I felt were trite, making me full of wonder when I see the natural world, the stars, people. And also recovery from particularly dark moments of my life. You know, it's a book I can turn to and escape into, find consolation in, find recovery in. There and back again. As I said at the start, when Tolkien arrived in this hospital, he had arrived in England just previously, a day previously, on a hospital ship from France. And his first story was of a mariner arriving in Tol Eressëa. And The Lord of the Rings ends with Frodo and Bilbo sailing on an elven ship to Tol Eressëa, the lonely isle of the elves, no longer associated with Britain by Tolkien. A far green country seen under a swift sunrise. Thank you.